Building produce can be a complicated procedure. In today's video, I'm going to walk you through the steps and procedures on how to load produce properly. If you didn't watch last week's video, grab the link below and have a watch of it. Check out the trailer carefully before you go to load. The first important step you need to remember is to check the trailer. The trailer has got to be clean. Hopefully the company has power washed the trailer out for you so the walls are clean, the floors have been swept out clean, the drainage holes at the back corners of the trailer are clean and devoid of wood chips and stuff like that. And you want to make sure that the reefer chute up at the front of the trailer is attached to the reefer unit itself and that the chute's in good order so you'll have airflow right to the back doors. Loading patterns. Let's have a look at these loading patterns. Now most skids are about 3.5 by 4. There are a few ways the fork truck guy can put them in for you. First, he'll put them in straight. Now that's not good because you've got a whole bunch of room on either side of the skids, and even if he puts them one side and then goes to the other side, you've still got these gaps where the skids can fall over. You don't want that, that's no good at all. The second pattern is chimney block, which is one straight in, one turned on its side. And this is a little better. And if you chimney block the entire load, depending on what it is, it'll transfer weight farther back in the trailer, and that's a good thing too. Now, there's still a little room for falling over, but it's not quite as bad, and you can still brace that with airbags or load locks or something like this. What I prefer to do is everything sideways, and it puts you hard to the walls on either side, so you can't have the skids don't have room to fall over either direction. Now, it does mean your weight's fairly far forward, so you've got to be careful. If this is okay for berries or lettuce or something like that, but you don't want to do that with broccoli. If you've got a heavy load, if your skids are heavy, you can always single the skids out. Build yourself a couple of singles on the nose, then put the doubles behind that. But you've got to brace these skids with vertical load locks up and down from the floor to the ceiling to hold these blocks in so they don't fall over. Skid height and weight. The next thing you've got to pay attention to are the different types of skids, the appearance of the skids, and the weight of the skids that you're loading. Different products weigh different things. Berries and lettuce are relatively light. Berries are fairly low and light, and I like to put them on the nose just for better weight distribution. Lettuce, for instance, if it's stacked high, you want to make sure you cross brace it so the skid doesn't lean and fall over. And if you're not careful, that'll happen as the trailer moves. It'll rock back and forth, and you don't want to flop over the lettuce. So you want to make sure you brace that properly, and part of that will be in the loading pattern. Something like broccoli, for instance, is very heavy. Now, the broccoli itself isn't heavy, but they ice the skids of broccoli. So generally, you want those at the back of the trailer because as the trailer travels, the ice will gradually melt off. And as the ice melts off, turns into water and runs down the sides, you want it to get out those free drain holes at the back. You don't want that water coursing through the length of the trailer and getting everything wet. You want it hard to the back where the water can just drain out and not be a problem. And also because the broccoli is heavy, the back is the best spot for it because it'll help you with your axle weights. Securing the load. The next thing you've got to pay attention to, as I touched on briefly with the lettuce, is that you've got to secure everything so it doesn't fall over in transit. Now, as I said, the high skids, the light skids, need to be braced somehow, either with load locks vertically or airbags. Some shippers use, and airbags are really nice to make sure the stuff doesn't move around. But part of this too will be in the loading pattern, and it'll all depend on how you want to put it on. I like to put everything side to side so there's no room between the skids. That way it doesn't move side to side, and then brace it backward and forward. But if you put the skids sideways on, it'll minimize the movement, minimize the airspace. If you chimney block it, there'll be a little more room, but a little more sway room. Now, if you put skids straight in, and you should virtually never do this with produce because it leaves big gaps on either side of the skids. And even if they stagger them like this, side to side, you're still going to get movement in there, and there's a chance that your skids can lose the top row or something like that. Stuff topples. The moment they peer in at the other end and see toppled skids, you're looking at a claim. You don't want that. So bracing these loads is very important. And that's why the loading pattern is so important as well. Product temperature. Now, as I touched on in the last video, product temperature is extremely important. That's why you need a pulper and you need to be on the dock checking the skids. And the way this works is, if you're not on the dock showing that you know what you're doing, the shippers half the time will take advantage of you because they're just minimum wage guys driving the fork trucks. They don't care. They want to get it done. So they'll just shove it in straight, the load will topple, and you'll have a big claim at the end of the trip. But if you're on there paying attention on the dock, bracing the skids as they go in, pulping the skids before they go on, they know then that you know what you're doing. And then they're less likely to give you hot skids or put it in an order that you don't want that's going to cause damage later down the road. So you've got to be on the dock. It's important to do that. And if you show that you don't care, those guys on the dock loading aren't going to care either. And those guys can tell. And they get a laugh at stuff that falls over the other end. So don't let them do it to you. Now, anyone hauling produce should carry a chart showing what products need what temperatures. But when you're loaded, get your bills. There will be a temperature on your bills. Check to see what that temperature is. Set your reefer to that temperature and make sure they match. Now, if you check your chart, and you should be doing this anyway, check your chart and it doesn't look like to you that that should be the right temperature. If they're telling you to run carrots at 34 degrees on the paperwork and that doesn't look right, you want to call your boss, you want to call the receiver, you want to call somebody, because that doesn't make sense. So match the paperwork temperature against your chart temperature just to make sure you're covered and everything's good. Sign your bills, close your doors, and you're ready to go. Now, there can be a huge temperature variance between the different products. Berries, for instance, run cool. Lettuce is very sensitive and can't handle much temperature swing. Lettuce has got to sit about 36 degrees. And the hardier stuff, like apples and stuff, it can run warmer. So it's important you pay attention to what product it is you're hauling. Now, bear in mind that reefers, the way they work is if you set the temperature for your reefer at 32 degrees, that reefer, as it fluctuates, will heat and cool and heat and cool. So if you've got your unit set at 32, at points there, the reefer is going to be 30, 29 degrees. It'll be blowing that air onto your romaine lettuce. So 32 is too cool to set it for lettuce. You want to be a couple of points, a couple of degrees above freezing temperature. It's better to have the stuff a wee bit warm than a wee bit cool and with frost on it, because that's the first thing they'll look for in a load of lettuce, for instance, is frost damage on these delicate leaves. They see any, you got a claim and you're in trouble. So if you're really, really close, if they tell you 32 degrees, bear in mind that it only takes you know, a swing of a couple of degrees to put frost on the product. You're better to run it just a tad warmer. Monitoring the reefer unit. Now let's talk about the reefer unit for a minute. It's important that you're trained before you leave the yard for your initial run on exactly how this monitor on the reefer unit works. You want to know how to set it, and you want to know how to manually defrost it. And you want to be able to understand how the things work. As I told you, the temperature will swing up and down from the set point, but make sure that you understand how to set the reefer on the temperature desired. Have an experienced guy show you, and a guy that's experienced on that particular unit and works for your company. Have a little training session before you go out so you completely understand how the unit works. You also want the company to equip you with a manual that shows how the reefer works in case you get into trouble, so you can study the manual and compare it against what they told you if you run into trouble, or what the bad indicator lights are telling you if there's a problem. But you also want a list of the different dealerships all over the country. So if you run into trouble, if your reefer quits here, you can look up in your book and go, oh, the nearest dealership where I can get repair is, give them a call, even if it's on the weekend, give them a call, say, hey, I'm coming into your yard, I'm in trouble here, the unit's quit. You've got to have this book with you and it'll help you out in emergency situations. Because the longer that unit is off, the more likely you're going to get into trouble. Because the box won't hold its temperature that long. It'll hold it longer if the stuff is at the right temperature when they load it, but it's still going to lose temperature after a while, especially if it's a really hot day or something like that. So you've got to have these emergency phone numbers when you need them right at the tip of your fingers, just in case. Now, some of the better reefer companies these days run a program offered by Thermo King that they can actually track, as you move, they can track the temperature of the box from wherever you are right back to their dispatch office. And that's a really handy thing to have. That's an option that the good carriers are going to, and it saves them claims. So check with your carrier, just so you know one way or the other. I'd want to know if they can monitor the box as well as you do. So that way, if it goes down in the middle of the night, for instance, and you're not aware of it because you're asleep, they can give you a call and let you know. Otherwise, and even in spite of that anyway, you should be checking this unit about every 4 hours just to make sure it's running properly. And if it starts to heat up, it probably just needs defrosting because it's accumulating ice on the condenser. So you want to know how to manually defrost the thing. These things should all automatically defrost themselves now, the way that the units are made. But just in case, keep an eye on it. And if it starts getting really, really warm, first thing to try is to defrost it. It'll kick on high, it'll heat, it'll melt the ice, and then it'll go back to temperature again. Final driving instructions. Now, hauling sensitive produce and reefer freight isn't like hauling boxes of dry freight. This stuff is all subject to vibration and bounce. You don't want the trailer heaving up and down over the rough roads because some of this stuff like berries will bruise and damage. So you've kind of got to drive it like you're driving Miss Daisy. Be gentle with the thing. No sudden stops, no sudden starts, no dumping the clutch, and no rocking and rolling through the curves like this. You've got to drive it gently. You've got to be careful with it. Everything in there is perishable and can be damaged by the wrong set of motions, or it can fall over. This is all going to help you avoid claims. You don't want claims, and that's just the way it is. It's as simple as that. Now, these days, the carriers, some of the carriers are starting to get into like LTL and multi-drop shipments, and they'll use multi-temp reefers and barrier walls, cold walls, to try to separate off different sections of the trailer so you can have warm product over here and cooler product behind it, then frozen product at the back or something like that. And some carriers are getting into that, but I would avoid that as a new driver. I would avoid that like the plague, because it just opens up the possibilities for problems. As an experienced reefer hauler, I avoided stuff like that like the plague. And these cold walls are just a pain in the butt to wrestle around. They're the full size of the opening of the trailer, and they're about this thick. So you can imagine how easy those are to maneuver. They're heavily insulated. You don't even want to get into that. And half the carriers won't even pay extra for it anyway. So just avoid the multi-temp reefers and the cold walls. I never found it was worth the hassle, and chances are you could get a claim. Something else you need to remember, and it's a common sense thing, and I'm sure you guys wouldn't make this mistake, but you've got to keep an eye on the fuel level in the reefer tank. You don't ever want to get that fuel too low, especially in the wintertime. You don't want the stuff to gel. You've got to keep an eye on the fuel level, because believe me, once those things suck the tank dry, they are hard to restart, very difficult. You don't want to get into that in the first place. Keep the level in the reefer tank half or better. So to summarize now the things we've talked about, here are the four things you really need to remember to do the load properly. Number one, make sure your load is well secured. Number two, make sure you monitor the temperature carefully at all times. Keep an eye on the trailer. Number three, drive gently. Don't rock and roll the thing. And number four, always make sure that you're at the right set point for the reefer unit to begin with. Make sure it matches the paperwork. Check everything three times just to make sure you've got it right. You don't want to travel 2,000 miles and find out that you were set at 48 degrees when the paper says 38 degrees. If you bear these four steps in mind, you'll enjoy reefer work. But you want to avoid those claims. We don't want to see you get any claims. They're expensive. Take care. Keep the rubber side down. I'll see you on the backhaul.